بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على النبي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to one and all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this concise discussion of ours in regards to Hajjat al-Wada' beneficial for all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us to the holy lands again and again. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alleviate this pandemic from the four corners of the world. May Allah connect us and the whole of humanity to His mercy and proximity. A forerunner to Hajjat al-Wada'. Before Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's Hajj, a few years prior to that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala paved the way for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first of all, to get to Makkah Mukarramah. It was the sixth year when Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw this dream, where himself and his Sahaba radiallahu anhum were going for Umrah and seeing the Kaaba, circumambulating, performing the Tawaf, performing the Umrah. Sahaba radiallahu anhum were very happy. They undertook this journey. And there Allah taught the Ummah a very important, pertinent lesson, that Allah makes things happen in the correct time. Sahaba radiallahu anhum were barred at an area called Hudaybiyah, and they were not allowed entry into Makkah Mukarramah. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, taught humanity a very great lesson here. He told them, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told you, you would perform Umrah, and definitely you will perform the Umrah. It's just the time Allah doesn't stipulate, and it'll happen in the right and correct time. So sixth year, let's all remember, Sulh al-Hudaybiyah takes place. Allah reveals Surah Al-Fath in the Quran al-Kareem, and this indicates to the opening of the hearts, like it also refers to future events like Fath Makkah, the conquering and the conquest of Makkah that will take place shortly thereafter. That was the sixth year. The Muslims weren't allowed to perform Umrah. They had to return to Medina Munawwara, but they accepted the decision of Allah. The seventh year, many interesting events took place. One, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now, because there was no anticipation of attacks from the Meccan side to Medina Munawwara, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now sent Sahaba radiallahu anhum to the countries of the world with letters inviting them to the greatness of Allah and to the deen of Allah and to the messengership and the prophethood of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his finality. Then in that year, Umratul Qadha takes place, the Qadha of the previous year's Umrah. That was the seventh year. In the eighth year, here also Allah Ta'ala made amazing events take place. Amazing, when we study Seerah, we learn this lesson, how Allah paves the way. Anyway, those events you have learned, it was so amazing, but that caused the conquest of Makkah Mukarramah, and Makkah was now in the hands of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Ummah. That was the eighth year. Now Makkah was in Muslim hands. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returned to Medina Munawwara after Fath Makkah. Then Hunain takes place, Taif takes place. But let's at least remember Fath Makkah, eighth year after Hijrah. Now ninth year came in. Then Dhul-Hijjah, the end of the year comes. A lot of events took place during that year. When Hajj time came in, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not perform Hajj that year. There's a lot of wisdom behind it. Number one, the Arabs would always change the dates. They would always change the dates according to their whims, because their sacred months, among the sacred months is the month of Dhul-Hijjah. And sometimes certain battles would take place, certain events they wanted to occur. And because it was not conducive to the sacred month, they would change it as they wanted to. And they would refer to this as Nasi'ah. Allah says, إِنَّمَا النَّسِيءُ زِيَادَةٌ فِي الْكُفْرِ. This is an increase in kufr, where they would change the dates as they wanted to. So the dates were not perfectly in order that year. And also there were certain inappropriate actions and practices still prevalent in Makkah that Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had to go and pave the way. And that was also wisdom presenting to the Ummah the importance and the position and the maqam and the status of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Because shortly after the departure of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu was designated for certain tasks. And as Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu catches up with the qafila and the caravan of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, See Sahaba's humility. Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu asked Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu, "Have you been sent as my Amir? So definitely I would comply. Why have you been sent?" He says, "No, I have been sent for announcements. I am under you, oh Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu." And that Hajj took place. This was a forerunner to Hajjatul Wada. Then Allah Ta'ala made it that the dates and the months fell into perfect proportion, and it came back to its original time. And that year was the 10th year. So this was the 9th year, Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's Hajj. The 10th year came in. Now the time was perfect. It was time for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam to perform this great amal, this great Hajj, this compulsion, and this important all-inclusive ibadah, wherein the entire ummah was gathered and they joined him in this beautiful performance of this Hajj, which is known as Hajjatul Wada', because it was a farewell Hajj where Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was performing, yes, this important Hajj, but it was a final Hajj, and it was also a time where he would soon be bidding farewell to his ummah, the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam announced to the ummah that he would be performing Hajj. And the ummah came from the length and the breadth of the lands. Sahaba radiallahu anhum had taken Islam to them. Now they had come to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and to get the glimpses of his blessings and his nur and his tawajjuh, from through which they would get this tajalli and the special ta'alluq with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the special status of being the Sahaba, the chosen ones, the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Every Sahabi is chosen by Allah. So many were there already with the close companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Others from far and wide took this opportunity to come and meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Interestingly, many were those who met him long ago, but they were waiting for this occasion to come and meet him. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam would remember them. Allahu Akbar. He would remember them. This was his dua and his worry and his concern for every one of his ummah. Anyway, Dhuhr Salah was performed in Al-Madinatul Munawwara on the 25th of Dhul Qa'dah. Because it was Dhuhr Salah, that's why the preferred view is that it was a Saturday. Then they departed. Asr Salah was performed in Dhul Hulayfa. The night was spent there. That night Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam had time and relation with all his wives that were with him in their specific times. And we learn from here, ulama deduce that it is mustahab for one to have relations with one's wife before donning the ihram. This is a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this was him fulfilling the huquq of all his wives radiyallahu anhum. And this is also where we learn the strength that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam had, the strength of 40 people of Jannah. Allah Ta'ala gave him such strength. That's why we learn that no one could ever put him down, but he never ever showed the strength to people. He never ever bashed or hurt or brought down people. Allahu Akbar. This was the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even Rukana, before he became radiyallahu anhu, when he tried to bring down the messenger of Allah in the wrestle, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed to the wrestle just to save him from Jahannam. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with ease brought down the mightiest wrestler of Arabia just to save him from Jahannam. This was Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's akhlaq. Anyway, the night was spent in Dhul Hulayfa. Then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam donned his ihram there, and he made niyyah of his qiran. Jibreel alayhi salam told him to make intention for Hajj and Umrah. And this was also to remove the practice of Jahiliyyah. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's every action has wisdom and has teachings. In Jahiliyyah, they would not perform Umrah in the days of Hajj. And Allah Ta'ala wanted to abolish this teaching through the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he gave his Sahaba radiallahu anhum the choice also of what to perform, ifrad or tamattu'. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then afterwards recited the labbaik. There's variant reports of where did he read the labbaik, from the masjid after his salah or as he was climbing up the hill, or when he got onto his conveyance, Sahaba radiallahu anhum, whoever were near him at that time, heard the labbaik at those different points. And what a beautiful rendition or song of the lover of Allah is the labbaik. Allahu Akbar. As we discussed previously, the labbaik in the first Sahabi radiallahu anhu to recite the labbaik, who was taught the labbaik by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam recited the labbaik, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum started reciting the labbaik. They passed by a valley called Aqiq. Jibreel alayhi salam comes, informs Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, reads Salah ayah. Allah says this is a Mubarak valley. Anyway, Sahaba radiallahu anhum were reading the labbaik. Jibreel alayhi salam came and instructed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, tell your Sahaba radiallahu anhum, فَلْيَرْفَعُوا أَصْوَاتَهُمْ بِالتَّلْبِيَةِ. Allah loves the talbiyah so much, let them raise their voices with the labbaik. The ummah, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum would raise their voices with the labbaik, because this was an instruction from Allah Ta'ala. Allah give us tawfiq. Today, sadly, it's very few who recite the labbaik. Alhamdulillah, sometimes you get this environment here, this ambiance where different communities come in from different countries and they're reciting the labbaik passionately and lovingly. Allah make us of those. Ulama write that it is one of the signs of Qiyamah, that a time would come where people would not read the labbaik. On these days of Hajj, a Haji's dhikr is labbaik. When he is in Ihram, his salam, Allah give us tawfiq to make salam to all, is labbaik. He's climbing up a hill is labbaik. He's going down the hill is labbaik. After salah, his dhikrullah is labbaik. A slogan of the lover of Allah Ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. So Sahaba radiallahu anhum would recite the labbaik loudly. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed different towns. Scholars of history document the names of these towns. Allah give us tawfiq to learn Sahaba's names radiallahu anhum, and even remember towns that Allah's Nabi passed. How Mubarak is the life of Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his teachings, that every aspect connected to him becomes ilm and becomes knowledge and becomes inspiration and becomes enlightenment and becomes nur and hidayat for one who learns it. Allah give us tawfiq. He passed through an area called Malal, Ruha, Afaya, Araj, Abwa, Usfan, some of these towns. When he passed Ruha, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed the Sahaba radiallahu anhum that 70 Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam performed their salaya in Ruha. Allahu Akbar. And we discussed this in our discussion of Badr, because Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed this region there also when he drank the water, and Sa'ad radiallahu anhu purchasing that well where Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam drank the water. We discussed this there. When Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed Araj, anyway, they camped there for a while, and the baggage of Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam was nowhere to be found. And Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu's baggage were kept together on one camel back, and the man in charge of keeping that was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's slave, or understand it to be a servant. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had this slave and he was on the khidmah and he was in charge of that camel. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is now upset. Why is he upset? Not for his own baggage, but someone connected to him, his servant, had caused takleef to Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is hurt and is upset that Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam needs his baggage, needs his luggage, whatever was needed for the journey was on there, and this man had misplaced the camel. The camel went wrong. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, hold on. You are in ihram, be cool, be calm. This is a report in Sunan Ibn Majah. We learn something from here, that in Hajj, we have to be tolerant, we have to be patient. One is the guest of Allah. Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through his journey, he taught the mu'min this. That's why it's interesting that a mu'min in his ihram, as we'll see in the other days also, Arafah, Muzdalifah, Mina, the haji doesn't fast. Why doesn't the haji fast when everyone around the world gains so much of rewards for fasting? Because the mu'min throughout the world is thinking about the haji and trying to imitate the haji in some sort of sacrifice. But the haji doesn't fast because he is the guest of Allah. Al-Hajju Wafdullah. This is the hikmah behind why the haji doesn't fast. And Allah Ta'ala takes care of his guests. Whatever his guest asks, Allah Ta'ala fulfills the need of his guest. And when his guest seeks forgiveness, Allah Ta'ala guarantees forgiveness for his special guest, the Haji, and for anyone on behalf of whom the Haji asks Allah Ta'ala. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. So, very importantly, also, this is part of the hikmat of Allah and the love of Allah, that Allah puts his Haji through a tarbiyat, a training, so that he comes and he becomes spiritually rejuvenated. So we learn from here, be tolerant, and in any situation, turn to Allah Ta'ala. Women go through different challenges, men go through different challenges. Sometimes we want certain things to happen, and sometimes we don't want certain things to happen. A simple thing like, sometimes it's halal, it's permissible for a woman to try and stop her bleeding, for example. But it happens that Allah Ta'ala willed it that it still comes, no matter what means she tried to stop it. What's the test at that time? Be happy with Allah Ta'ala. Turn to Allah Ta'ala and have this conviction that, oh my Allah, you will do for me what is best. I would love to quote Umar radiallahu anhu's statement. So beautifully he says, Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, عَرَفْتُ رَبِّي بِفَسْخِ عَزَائِمِي. He says, we recognize Allah through so many means. He says, one way of how I recognize Allah is sometimes I want something to happen so badly, and I fulfill every means in the fulfillment. I carry out every means in the fulfillment of that wish or that intention that I have. But Allah Ta'ala makes it that it doesn't happen. He says, what I realize is Allah is in control, Allah is the doer, Allah is the one that causes things to happen, and Allah is that being who makes it not happen as he wants. So one, Allah is in control. That's how I recognize Allah. In the situation where the goods of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was missing, Sa'd radiallahu anhu and Abu Qais radiallahu anhu understood what had happened. So they came quickly and they bidded Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Nabi of Allah, please accept our goods. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, may Allah bless you. And with Allah's grace, our camel and our goods have been found. So Allah Ta'ala showed Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam where the camel went off, and he sent the Sahabi radiallahu anhu to bring the camel back. Alhamdulillah. So we learn, no matter what situation, turn to Allah Ta'ala, and if Allah Ta'ala takes something, Allah Ta'ala will give much more, and Allah will give better. As they come to a place called Usfan, near Makkah Mukarramah, Suraqa radiallahu anhu, great Sahabi, Suraqa radiallahu anhu, remember him? He tried to capture Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the journey of Hijrah, and what a great Sahabi he became. Suraqa, it means something, someone valuable that everyone wants to steal. Suraqa. He comes to Allah's Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Nabi of Allah, teach us as though we are newborn babies. Allah's Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught him different aspects and how to enter Makkah Mukarramah and so forth. Then they come to a place called Sarif, and here Aisha radiallahu anha started her menstruation. As a result of this, she was crying, she was weeping. Oh, and she said, hey, what's going to happen to my journey now? Is my journey a waste? Hajj is near. How is it? How this happened? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came there. He finds her crying. He consoles her. No, Aisha, this is indeed something that happens to every person. This is Allah Ta'ala's will. It's not such a big situation. Allah Ta'ala will solve it. Don't worry. He put her fears to ease, and then she was calmed. He gave her himmah, and alhamdulillah, the journey continued, and she performed her hajj. And afterwards, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent her to make up whatever would have been missed, and so forth. Then, very near Makkah, at a valley called Azraq, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to his sahaba radhiyallahu anhum, I see now before me the moment when Musa alayhi salam passed this way for hajj, with his fingers in his ears, loudly crying out the labbaik. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Labbaik, Allahumma labbaik, labbaik, la sharika laka labbaik, innal hamda wal ni'mata laka wal mulk, la sharika lak. At the Tu'a, which is very near Makkah Mukarramah, Allah's Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam spent the night there. Then in the morning he performed ghusl once more for entrance into Makkah. That was the reason for that ghusl, to enter into Makkah Mukarramah. And thereafter, at the time of Duha on Sunday, the 4th of Dhul Hijjah, Allah's Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Makkah Mukarramah. And then from there he went straight to Al-Masjid Al-Haram, and he went straight to kiss the Hajar Aswad, and he started his tawaf. there was no tahiyatul masjid salah performed at that time. After Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's tawaf, then he performed the 2 rakat salah behind the maqam Ibrahim. After sa'i, Rasulullah between Safa and Marwa, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed his sahaba radiallahu anhu, whoever didn't have the hadi animals along with them, to come out of ihram. And he remained in his ihram because his was qiran and most of them performed the tamattu. And then he remained in Makkah Mukarramah for 4 more days. Then on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, it's known as Yawm al-Tarwiyah, they would actually give their camels water at that time, keep it ready because of the journey between Mina and Arafah. Anyway, Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after charged, went to Mina and he performed five salahs there, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha and Fajr on the 9th. That night Suratul Mursalat was revealed. On Friday the 9th, after sunrise, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam departed with his Sahaba radiallahu anhum and they went to Arafah. Sahaba radiallahu anhum pitched a tent for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam near Masjid Namira and he spent some time there. Then he came out and he presented his khutbah to the Ummah. Allahu Akbar. And in all these days, Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam presented his khutbah entailing different topics and aspects of deen, topics that cover the whole of deen, because this is known as Hajjatul Wada', the farewell. And in this, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah knows whether you would see me after this again, so take the deen from me. And then different aspects of deen was covered. One of the very, very important aspects of Islam was emphasized by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is respect for each and every person. For example, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Oh my Ummah, what day is this? What month is this? What lands are these?" Now, Sahaba radiallahu anhum were intrigued by this. Is Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam going to call it something else? No. He was actually emphasizing something that they knew. And he was drawing a lesson that like this day is sacred, this month is sacred, these lands are so sacred and respected. "Oh my Ummah, inna dima'akum wa amwalakum wa a'radakum haramun alaykum ka hurmati yawmikum hadha fi shahrikum hadha." Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that like this day is sacred, like this month is sacred, like these lands are sacred, every person's life is respected and honored. Every person's wealth should not be usurped. It's his haqq. And every person's honor is preserved. Every person should be honored and respected. Allahu Akbar. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized this. That like we respect these lands and respect these days and respect these months, we have to respect each other. Irrespective of color, race, nationality, language, this was emphasized. Respect for every person. Never look down upon the next person. Allah loves each one. Allah never judges people for their color, for their race, for their nationality, or from the tribe they come from. Allah's Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized this. And even this was proven from the fact that when he came to Arafah, it was Quraysh who would never come out of the haram, because Arafah is out of the haram. They would say that we are Allah's people, we cannot come out of the haram. Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam showed that everyone is equal before Allah. We go to Arafah. Arafah is valuable. We are all the servants of Allah Ta'ala and everyone is equal. This was one aspect highlighted in the different khutbahs. Then in the other days also, Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlighted so many different teachings, ya Allah. So many beautiful different teachings. One teaching during the days of Araf, of Hajj, open hayat with Sahaba of Maulana Yusuf rahmatullahi, and he quotes with the chain of reporters that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's different advices on different occasions. Like one beautiful advice, he said that make akhirah your goal and your purpose and your objective in life. Man ja'ala al-humum hamman wahidan. From all your worries, make your main worry the worry of akhirah. Make the year after the fikr for the akhirah your purpose and your goal. If that is our goal and our purpose, the small nitty gritty issues of this world will not become troublesome for us, because we know that all this has to be left. We have to please Allah Ta'ala. Allah must become happy, because when we leave this world, all these issues will not be important at all. Then Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah will care, Allah will worry for your worldly worries when you make Allah your goal and your purpose and your objective. But the one who makes dunya his goal and objective and purpose, Allah will let his mind go into the different valleys and aspects of this world, and then he'll get destroyed in those valleys. This was Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam's advisors in these days. And then he also said, "Oh my ummah, whatever you learn, naddarallahu mra'an." He made dua. "Oh Allah, give luster, give beauty, give brightness, give freshness, give youthfulness, nadara, to that person who will hear my teachings, take it in himself, and then impart it to others." What a dua Allah's Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. And in that advice, he gave the importance of unity and how dua becomes strong when we are united, and how he gave advice of sincerity towards every person, especially to the leaders and to every ummati of Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was one of the lessons. And another very important advice he gave was treatment of women, how we should respect and be kind to our women folk. And Allah's Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized this in quite a few of the khutbas. And then also, he emphasized that matters of jahiliyyah are abolished. Matters of the past should not be brought up again. Things like murders that took place in the past. And he also emphasized one specific murder. His own uncle's son, Rabi'a Damu ibn Rabi'a ibn al-Harith. So Rabi'a was Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's cousin, because Harith is Abdul Muttalib's eldest son. You can remember in the seerah, Abdul Muttalib had two views, 10 sons or 12 sons. And his eldest son was Harith. When he was digging for Zamzam next to Kaaba, he had Harith at that time. And he took that vow, "Allah, I'll sacrifice one for you if you give me 10. Harith was his son at that time. Now Harith's son was Rabi'a, who's Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam's cousin. And Rabi'a had an infant child, and this child was suckling in Banu Sa'd. And the Hudayl tribe came and killed this infant. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, for example, that issue should not be brought up again. It's the past. Leave jahiliyyah. Carry on further. So he said, start with my own. This is my own nephew, but this matter should be passed. Let's carry on. Allah gave us Islam. Aspects like that. Even usury, riba. What destruction riba brings to a person's life. Quran announces, this is an ultimatum of war with Allah. Allah save us from riba. Allah save us from involving ourselves with things that displease Allah Ta'ala like this. Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, all this riba is totally abolished in Islam. It is abrogated. It is not permissible. Mawdu'a tahta qadamayya. I trample it under my feet. And he says, I start with that of my uncle Abbas. Abbas radiallahu anhu. Whatever riba he was collecting also is abolished. And if you owe anything to him, that is, as far as usury is concerned, I wipe it out. Yes, your capital you can keep. This was how Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized. Then interestingly, in every one of his khutbas, he said to his ummah, my deen must be taken and imparted to the four corners of the world. Allahu Akbar. This is an aspect Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized. This was part and parcel of Al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's teachings. What was this? Throughout his life, during the Medina period and during the Makkah period, in many of the hadith, we'll find this repetition. That's why in Sunan Ibn Majah, he brings this hadith so many times. Generally, the Musannif rahimahullah, Muhammad ibn Yazid ibn Majah rahimahullah, brings this hadith one time. Brings a hadith one time in his kitab. But there's few hadith that he highlights. Like this hadith of imparting the knowledge of deen and imparting the dawat of deen, he brings this hadith more than 7 times in the one chapter. Emphasizing, this is something Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized throughout his Mubarak life. Whenever he would teach something, at the end he would say, now pass it on to others. Now pass it on to others. It is an amana. What we learn and then to share it with others is the amana of this deen. Here in Hajjatul Wada as well, in every one of his khutbas, like the importance of respecting the next was emphasized and highlighted, this aspect was also highlighted, repeated and emphasized. That فَلْيُبَلِّغْ الشَّاهِدُ مِنْكُمُ الْغَائِبُ فَلْيُبَلِّغْ شَاهِدُكُمْ غَائِبَكُمْ. In different ways, Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, every one of you that I hear, now take this message of my entire deen and convey it to humanity. Every person that's not here has to get this full message. فَلْيُبَلِّغْ. Those that are here must convey it. must impart it. And then in other hadith, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, sometimes Allah will make it that the one who receives it will impart it more. Obviously, nobody can be better than Sahaba radiallahu anhum and nobler than Sahaba radiallahu anhum, but this was encouraging his ummah throughout the annals of the coming times, that take this deen and pass it on. That will be your investment in the future. That will be your legacy in this dunya, that you left a mark on this earth of the name of Allah Ta'ala, the deen of Allah Ta'ala, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the teachings of Kalamullah, the teachings of deen. And how, what a great means of reward is this. How many hajj can one person go for? How many Qur'ans a person can memorize? How many sunan a person can bring into his life? But when one brings it into his own life and imparts it into the lives of others, whatever they will do, Allah will give him the full reward. What an investment is this imparting in the deen of Allah Ta'ala. Allah give us tawfiq. And Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam emphasized this aspect of respect even further. After his khutbah, then Bilal radiallahu anhu presented the adhan. He rendered the adhan so beautifully. Everyone heard. Then Dhuhr and Asr was performed together at Dhuhr time. Then Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went further onto his camel. And then after that, he made dua. He made dua and made dua and made dua and made dua. Dua for his ummah. He begged Allah for his ummah. He beseeched Allah for his ummah. Oh Allah, my ummah. Oh Allah, my ummah. Oh Allah, my ummah. Ummah that were there. Ummah that are to come. Ummah that are the wrongdoers. Ummah that are the oppressed. Everyone was covered. Ya Allah. He cried and he cried and he cried. Read this in the kitabs of Seerah, how Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cried. Ummul Fadl radiallahu anha. What a great sahabiya. Abbas radiallahu anhu's wife. Maymuna radiallahu anha's sister. She was thinking, is Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasting? So before sunset, she sent milk. So Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to show everyone that I'm not fasting, sat on the camel and drank that milk. But he continued his dua right till sunset. Hours and hours and hours of beseeching Allah. Anyway, when the sun had set, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was waiting to depart. And everyone is anticipating, who is he waiting for? And one young sahabi of dark skin, mother was African origin. Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was practically showing humanity that color means nothing. Heart is what is valuable. Color is all equal before Allah. He said it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught it and he showed it practically. Usama bin Zayd climbs onto the camel with Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there were few people who were new to Islam, commented something. What? Everyone was made to wait for this person. Mu'arrikheen write that those who uttered these comments later on were punished by Allah with irtidad because of disrespect for a sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Allah, Allah save us from disrespect. A person who loses iman. Usama radiallahu anhu was with Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on this journey. Then a point came where Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam needed to relieve himself. Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhu was there. Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam relieved himself. They asked him, would you want to perform salah? He said, no, salah is at Muzdalifah, further on. And then he continued. And Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhu, look at love for sunnah. All his life, he would stop at that point and relieve himself there. Not that he needed to relieve himself later on. It was because of something that Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. Sahaba took the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be binding on themselves. This is love for Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then at Muzdalifah, that night is spent. Ya Allah, what a night. The night where every mu'min, the sky is the roof. It is an occasion where the haji has the opportunity to feel like how that needy, poor individual is feeling that we see in different countries of the world. Yes, we give a few pennies and we walk away and we feel satisfied. But this is that occasion where we realize that every one of us are beggars before Allah. We get the opportunity to take that brick and lie down on it and feel humbled before Allah. That Allah, you are one, you are unique, you are pure, you are perfect. You need nothing and no one, and everything and everyone is totally in need of you, my mighty, my merciful Allah. This is what Hajj is about, to connect with Allah, to communicate with Allah, to learn about the love of Allah it is a spiritual journey, not like any other ibadah, which is important. But here, this is the journey of the lover and someone who is going to learn love. That's why the pious predecessors would say so beautifully. He would say, إِلَيْكَ قَصْدِي رَبَّ الْبَيْتِ وَالْحِجْرِ فَأَنْتَ سُؤْلِي مِنْ حَجِّي وَمِنْ عُمَرِي وَفِيكَ سَعْيِي وَتَطْوَافِي وَمُزْدَلِفِي وَالْهَدْيُ جِسْمِ الَّذِي يُغْنِي عَنِ الْجَزْرِ ومسجد الخيف خوفي من تباعدكم ومشعري ومقامي دونكم خطري زادي رجائي لكم والشوق راحلتي والماء من عبراتي والهوى سفري. He says, إليك قصدي. Oh my Allah, I'm on a search for you. رب البيت, you are the Lord of Kaaba. والحجري, and the Lord of the semicircle connected to Kaaba, which is part and parcel of Kaaba. Allah, I've come to ask you for you. فَأَنْتَ سُؤْلِي. I've come for you. Through my Hajj and my Umrah, my search is you, my Allah. And Allah says, oh my Banda, search for me, you will find me. وَفِيكَ سَعْيِي. When I'm running between Safa and Marwa and around my Tawaf, Allah, it's for you. It is in search for your pleasure. My Muzdalifa, all this is for you, my Allah. And when I'm sacrificing that animal, I'm actually sacrificing my nafs, my own self, that doesn't need to be physically slaughtered, but needs to be put secondary for your pleasure, that has to be priority. Oh Allah, when I come to Masjidul Khayf, it is to teach me that I must stay away from anything that will distance me from you. And oh my Allah, when I come to the mawqif of Arafah and Mina, I learn that you must be in my mind and my concentration. Zadi Raja'i Lakum. And what is my provision on my journey is my aspiration for you, Allah. My conveyance is my shauq for you, Allah. And my water is the tears that I must shed for you, Allah. When Allah Wala puts it like that, and then Ibn Rajab Rahimahullah quotes another so beautifully. He says, لَإِن لَمْ أَحُجَّ الْبَيْتَ أَوْ شَطَّ رَبْعِهِ حججت إلى من لا يغيب عن الذكر فأحرمت من وقتي بخلع نقائصي أطوف وأسعى في اللطائف والبر صفايا صفائي عن صفاتي ومروتي مروءة قلبي عن سوى حبه قفر وفي عرفات الأنس بالله موقفي ومزدلف الزلفى لديه إلى الحشر وبت المنى مني مبيتي في منى ورمي جماري جمر شوقي في صدري وإشعار هدي ذبح نفسي بقهرها وخلعي بمحو الكائنات عن السر ومن رام نفرا بعد نسك فإنني مقيم على نسكي حياتي بلا نفري. He says, my Hajj is not just to Baytullah. Baytullah is part of it, but my Hajj is to that being who I have to be in dhikr of all the time, who doesn't come out of my mind. I make ihram from the miqat, and my ihram is to leave all evil. And for this, I will strive and rush fil lataif in the love of Allah, in that which Allah loves, wal birri, and all righteous deeds. Not barri, birri. Bar is land, bir is righteous deeds. Safa ya safa'i, my Safa, when I climb on Safa, on Mount Safa, it's to teach me I must cleanse myself from the qualities Allah doesn't like. An sifati wa marwati, and my marwa is to make my heart clean from everything else that Allah dislikes, and from everything else besides Allah. And in Arafat, I must learn to recognize Allah and be comfortable with that closeness to Allah. And that's my mawqif in Arafat. And my Muzdalifa, wa Muzdalifi, az-zulfa ladayhi ila al-hashri, is to remind me that I'm going to stand before Allah on the Day of Judgment. And my nights in Mina, wa battal muna minni, mabitiya fi Mina. My nights being spent in Mina is to teach me to cut off my passions and desires of this world, that this will be left and sacrificed. وَرَمْيُ جِمَارِي جَمْرُ شَوْقِيَ فِي صَدْرِي. And my رَمْيُ الْجِمَارِ is to actually throw out those passions in my heart. وَإِشْعَارُ هَدِي, and marking my sacrificial animal is to teach me that I have to sacrifice my nafs by controlling it biqahriha, and to remove from me the garments of everything else besides Allah from my consciousness and from my heart. This is that level of the love of Allah. Allah give us glimpses of this love. Then he says, after your hajj you can leave. وَمَنْ رَامَ نَفْرًا. He who intends to depart after his hajj, بَعْدَ نُسْكٍ, after his nusuk. فَإِنَّنِي, he says, myself, مُقِيمٌ عَلَى نُسْكِي حَيَاتِي بِلَا نَفْرِي. All my life I will remain in the mindset of hajj. وَمَنْ رَامَ نَفْرًا بَعْدَ نُسْكٍ فَإِنَّنِي مُقِيمٌ عَلَى نُسْكِي حَيَاتِي بِلَا نَفْرِي. This is what hajj is. It's the journey of the love of Allah Ta'ala. Allah give us tawfiq. Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remained in Mina and pelted all 3 days. Quran gives permission for 2 days or the third, obviously with the preferability of staying the extra day, meaning the third. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pelted for those days, and then after the Dhuhr Salah, pelting on that day, he then departs to an area called Al-Muhassab or Al-Hasba. Abdul Aziz bin Rufay' rahimahullah says, I asked Hazrat Anas radiallahu anhu, tell me what you remember from Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On this third day of pelting, where did he perform Dhuhr Salah? Hazrat Anas radiallahu anhu said, at Mina. Then I asked him, where did he perform Asr Salah? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on this day performed Asr Salah at Abtah or Batah, meaning Al-Muhassab. So Asr, Maghrib, Isha Salahs were performed there. Now there's a discussion in regards to this practice of going to Muhassab after the Hajj. Is it a Sunnah practice? This is a difference of opinion. There's an amazing report from Hazrat Usama radiallahu anhu, wherein he said, I asked Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Nabi of Allah, tomorrow where will we be heading to? Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, tomorrow we are going to Khayf Bani Kinana. This is Al-Abtah. And this is the place, O Usama, حَيْثُ تَقَاسَمُوا عَلَى الْكُفْرِ, where the forces of Batil, where the unbelievers gathered to discuss their sinister plans of falsehood and disbelief. So we learn from here that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's departure to that area and his camping at that place specifically was with a great objective. Meaning where they were making the worry and the concern of Batil, we will go there and make the remembrance of Allah and please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And really, this is a very important lesson for us. Wherever forces of Batil are taking place, efforts of Batil are taking place, we should go there with the correct fikr, with the correct worry, with the ibadat of Allah ta'ala, with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we learn this strategy and this practice from the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah's remembrance on a certain land, Allah's deen taking place, the effort of deen taking place in certain places, it alleviates pandemics, it removes calamities, it brings and draws the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what emphasizes this practice further is the understanding of Sahaba radiallahu anhum, because the Khulafa Rashidun, after their Hajj, they would also spend this time on this day at that same area wherein they saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam spend that time and rest. Allama Nawawi rahimahullah mentions that the practice of the majority is that it is highly encouraged to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in regards to this practice as well, and also follow the Khulafa Rashidin. And yes, there isn't sin for the one who doesn't go to Batha and spend those hours there and perform those salawat there. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to love the sunnah, and may Allah enable us to aspire to practice and bring alive the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all his sunan in our lives. May Allah bless the Ottoman Khilafah, wherein they even built masajid in important areas like these. Like in this area, exactly where Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent these hours, they constructed a masjid there that stands up till today, alhamdulillah, wherein it's available for people to go there and practice this beautiful sunnah. Then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam departed to the Kaaba Sharif, performed tawaful wada'. There is a difference of opinion as to whether he entered the Kaaba on this occasion or not. But yes, he did enter on the occasion of Fath Makkah, the conquest of Makkah, which was the 8th year. But did he enter sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the Kaaba Sharif on the occasion of Hajjatul Wada'? It is not confirmed. After that night, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performed the Fajr Salah in the Haram, reciting Surah At-Tur. Hazrat Ummu Salama radiallahu anha says she heard the recital of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of Abu At-Tur while she was performing her tawaf. Interestingly, Hazrat Umm Salama al-Makhzumiyya radiyallahu anha, our mother Umm al-Mu'mineen, was the last of the Ummahatul Mu'mineen to live and remain in this worldly life. She was the last of those to leave this world, of the Ummahatul Mu'mineen. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then departed from Makkah Mukarramah, from the path, from the road called Quda, and he took Zamzam water with him. Interesting is his departure from this route. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's entry was from one route and he departed from this route. It seems that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's beautiful practice of walking on different paths with the dhikr of Allah, with the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was practiced on this occasion as well. And also, it also would be that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left Makkah Mukarramah on his hijrah from this, on the same route, but in concealment. But now in the shukr of Allah ta'ala, openly he departed on the same route. And interestingly, he also, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, entered Makkah Mukarramah from this route, Quda, when he conquered Makkah Mukarramah as well, when he entered that grand entry of humility and victory. So we learn these beautiful practices of Allah's Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, taking Allah's name on every route, in all areas. As believers, we should aspire to bring alive this beautiful practice and this beautiful sunnah of remembering Allah everywhere, taking Allah's name everywhere, so that more lands can bear testimony to our worship of Allah Ta'ala and our remembrance of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. May Allah give us tawfiq. Shukr, as we mentioned, Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam took Zamzam water with him as well. What Mubarak water! Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala answers the du'as of one who prays on drinking that blessed water. Then our Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam departed and he journeyed to Medina Munawwara. And as he was on his route, he traveled a great distance on that route. And all the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, who came from different areas and regions and countries and vicinities, had now all returned. And then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was left with those Sahaba who came from Medina Munawwara. So he reaches an area called Ghadir Khum, which is near an area near to Medina Munawwara called Juhfa. So in this area, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to the Ummah the great virtues of Hazrat Ali radiyallahu anhu. Certainly there are some forces who try and misunderstand and misconstrue this incident. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't explain the virtues of Hazrat Ali radiyallahu anhu in Makkah Mukarramah or during the Hajj and so forth. This was after he departed from Hajj. Everyone had gone home. He's nearing Medina Munawwara. He gathered Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, who are now returning with him to Medina Munawwara. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted those Sahaba who were with Hazrat Ali radiyallahu anhu on his journey prior to this in Yemen, because there were some misunderstandings where some accused Hazrat Ali radiyallahu anhu. So Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to clarify the innocence of Hazrat Ali radiyallahu anhu. That's why he explained the virtues of Hazrat Ali radiyallahu anhu on this occasion. And yes, he is one of the greatest Sahaba radiyallahu anhum. To be precise, the fourth greatest of all the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum is our Hazrat Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And as people of Iman, we love and respect and revere and follow and emulate all the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq and give us the understanding of the beautiful life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum. And certainly, according to Quran, it is a sign of kufr to feel any hatred in the heart on hearing about any Sahabi radiyallahu anhu, because Allah says in Surah Al-Fath, لِيَغِيظَ بِهِمُ الْكُفَّارِ. The disbeliever is one who would be enraged by hearing about the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, because the person of Iman, a mu'min, his Iman would become enhanced and strengthened on hearing about the lifestyle and the beautiful life of the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continued his journey to Medina Munawwara, and then came the last few months, some of the saddest months for the Ummah in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because shortly he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be departing from this transitory world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq. Barakallahu feekum wa sallallahu ala nabiyil ummi bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.